Good morning. I'm Jon Evans. I'm one of our elders. I'm not one of our pastors. They've all introduced themselves this morning. Jim, three times. That's beautiful. Pastor Kevin is out of town this week, so I have the honor of pinch hitting for him. These gentlemen have Bibles. If you don't have a Bible with you, raise your hand. They'll be glad to hand one to you. If you don't have a Bible of your own, feel free to take this with you as our gift to you. We'll be looking at the scriptures together here in a little bit. You may have noticed, if you read the sign when you came in, our topic this morning is not on the sign. If you're a recipient of our text messages on Saturdays, you'll notice our topic was not on the text message. Now, that may be because when you talk about money, it might scare people off. So we thought, well, let's just put something nice on the sign like Jesus loves you, and we'll see more people here, and people won't keep going on to IHOP or something. Okay, so anyways, that's where we are. We are going to talk about money. And if you're a guest with us this morning, we're glad you're here. Hope you come back next week when Pastor Kevin's back in the pulpit. But why? Why would we do that? Well, first of all, the scripture talks a lot about it. Over 3,000 times, there's references to money and finances and riches and stewardship. And so if we're going to teach the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, then we've got to talk about it. Second reason is if you go to Amazon and just search for books about money, you'll come up with over 200,000. That suggests to me that there is confusion. There's a lot of different opinions about how and what and where and when and what are we supposed to do. And I guarantee we'll end up with misunderstandings about the best way to deal with money if we are not careful. So that's what we're going to do. Two promises or two things before we begin this morning. First of all, the timing of this message has nothing to do with the fact that we didn't have church last week and there was no offering, okay? It's purely coincidental. This has been on the books for several months. So anyways, that's not the reason we're here. And the second thing is this is not a prelude to a guilt trip or a fundraising campaign that begins next week, okay? That's not what we're going to do. I promise you that I'm not going to talk about what you should give, where you should give, or how you should give, okay? At our church, we believe that the amount and the method, the target, or private matters between you and the Lord, okay? So that's my promise to you, and I'll seek to fulfill it. So let's pray and trust the Lord to guide us this morning. Father, we pray as we delve into a matter that is of significance, yet makes us uncomfortable, that you would guide us and that it would be your word that would speak to our hearts. Lead us today in the path you want us to go. For it's in your name we ask and pray. Amen. When Rick Warren was getting ready to launch Saddleback Church in the early 1980s in Southern California, he went door to door and he asked people the simple question, why don't you go to church? Or what don't you like about church? And there were several answers, three of which I'd like to share with you. The first was, well, the messages and the sermons are not relevant to my life. The second reason that came up with, well, I got children and nobody's going to watch them. And the third thing that came up was, well, the church is always asking for money. Well, Faith Community Church was founded before Saddleback Church. And the reality is we have always preached the Word of God. And I believe if you preach the Word of God, then you remain relevant forever. Why? Because it's God's Word. It's timeless truth. And so that's been our key. Secondly, as a church, we've always focused on children's ministry. It's one of the things that drew our family here. If your children are in Sunday school, your children are in Awana, your children are in Vacation Bible School, they will hear the clear message of the gospel regularly and consistently. Additionally, we have Kid Check to make sure that you and only you take your children home. I know some of you would like to rent your children out for a little bit, but by and large, we want you to take your children home. All of our teachers undergo background checks, and we have security measures in place in case there's some type of an incident. So we care about and we watch over your children. And when it comes to money, we don't ask you for money very often. Doesn't come up much. We don't have a four-part series every January where we talk about starting the year right and talking about money. We have offering boxes in the back so we don't put you on the spot with regard to what you give, how often you give, or how much you give. A story was shared with me a few weeks ago. A couple started attending our church, and they're in the audience this morning, so forgive me. I didn't ask permission, but I think I'll be okay. She was putting a prayer request in the box every week, and he thought, well, that was interesting. Every week she's putting a prayer request in. So he asked his wife, he said, so what's the prayer request you're putting in there? And she said, I'm not putting in prayer requests, I'm putting in money. Isn't that the way it ought to be? We just don't even know, right? And so that's how we work as a church. We don't not interested in pledges and things like that. We just want you to give as the Lord leads. Now, some of you are thinking, well, John, I've been in this church for 5 years and I've never heard a message on money. I said, well, I've been in the church for 10 years and I've never heard a message on money, so you're not alone. And if you look on your bulletin, there's a little number after the sermon. It says 3,703. That says this is sermon number 3,703 from this pulpit. Now, I've only been here for about 500 of them, but I'm not sure that I have either. You say, well, if it makes everybody uncomfortable, then why would you talk about it? Well, let me give you three quotes from famous people about money to show us that money really is a problem. The idea of pursuing material objects your whole life is absolutely soulless. Any idea who said that? Plato, Aristotle, Socrates. No, it was Leonardo DiCaprio. Okay, so similar genre there, per se. How about this one? He that is of the opinion money will do everything may well be suspected of doing everything for money. Slightly more philosophical guy, Benjamin Franklin. And then we come to 1 Timothy chapter 6. For we brought nothing into the world, we can take nothing out of it, but if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. People who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. That's the Apostle Paul in 1 Timothy. So believe it or not, money's a problem. And it's not money itself. It's our perspective of money. If we have an objective to pursue money, if we worry and fret about money, if we promote money as a primary goal, we're going to end up way off course with regard to where God wants our lives to be. Now, we could take a lot of avenues this morning when it comes to finances. We could talk about incomes. We could talk about investing. We could talk about saving. We could talk about all sorts of things. But we're only going to talk about one aspect, and that's the concept of giving. God wants, I believe, our entire financial picture to be in order. And the scriptures has a lot to say about that. And if you're in a financial pickle of some sort, particularly one that's of your own doing, we trust that you'll seek wisdom and trust the Lord to help you get out of that. But the reason we're going to deal with giving is because I believe giving ought to be the priority and not the afterthought. I believe that the normal Christian life involves giving. And what mature believers and followers of Jesus Christ do is they look at what they have and they trust the Lord to do amazing things with it. And that's what biblical giving is. It's a reflection of my relationship with God. You know, it was announced in October that the show Mythbusters is going to stop filming. How many of you have seen Mythbusters? Okay, a couple of special effects experts who set about to prove and disprove urban myths and things you see on television or see in a movie. Can you really do that kind of thing? Here are a couple of the myths that they've busted over the years. If you drink soda and eat Pop Rocks, your stomach will not explode. In case you're wondering, myth has been busted. They've tested whether an airplane toilet seat could create enough suction to pull you into it, okay? I think they busted that one. Here's one I don't know the outcome was, but is it better to run or walk to keep dry when it's raining? All right, someone knows. Okay, I didn't know the answer to that one, but they've worked on that. So anyways, we're going to do a little myth-busting this morning, and before we get to myth-busting about finances, you know, there's a popular myth floating around in churches and our society that I think is pretty critical, and that myth is the fact that some are saying that we all worship the same God, and whether Muslims or Christians, it's all the same God. So I want to go off on a little tangent here this morning and just deal with this. It is true that Muslims believe that there is one Almighty, and that is, they call him Allah. And we as Christians believe there is one Almighty Creator God. We refer to him as God. We refer to him as Lord. And that's where the similarities end. Look at three things about Islam. First of all, Muslims claim that Jesus was merely human. He's not a god, nor is he the god. They believe that that there are many sons of God in the world, and then they get their direction from Muhammad, their primary prophet, and his revelation comes through the Quran. They believe that salvation comes through works. On the day of judgment, if a Muslim's good works outweigh his bad, and if Allah so wills it, then he may be forgiven of all his sins and enter into paradise. Specifically, prayers, alms, fasting, and living according to the Quran are the essentials. And finally, when it comes to their enemies or comes to unbelievers, this is from a pro-Islamic website. It says, suicide bomber is a derogatory term invented in the West to describe what in Islam is known as fadayin or shaheed, a martyr. The point of the bomber isn't suicide, it's to kill infidels in battle. This, the killing of infidels, is not just permitted by Muhammad, but encouraged with liberal promises of rewards in heaven. That's what Islam teaches. So what does the Word of God teach? Well, first of all, the Scriptures refer to those who've put their trust in Christ as sons of God and children of God. But Jesus Christ stands distinct from all of those in that he is the one and only begotten Son of God, John 3:16. And though in human form, he was fully God and fully man. Our direction comes from the Word of God, which is God's final written revelation to us. Secondly, we believe that salvation comes by grace alone, through faith alone, and Christ alone. Ephesians 2:8 and 9, and our works, our righteous acts, do absolutely nothing when it comes to salvation. They are worthless in terms of earning us favor with God. And then instructions we receive from Christ himself about those who disagree with us, those who hate us, those who despise us. Matthew 5, Jesus said, you've heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor, hate your enemy, but I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. And then in Hebrews 10, verse 30, we have, for we know him, that is God, who says, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. And again, he says, the Lord will judge his people. So my conclusion about the myth that we all worship the same God is that that one's busted. It's not the same God. Now, back to our regularly scheduled program. Minute, money. Money myth number one. Real popular one. I should give because God wants me to be rich and happy and giving is the key. Whew, wouldn't that be nice? Fills churches on Sunday morning, fills offering plates all across the country. But is it true? And the short answer is no. You say, but wait a second. So you're saying that God wants me to be poor and miserable? No, I didn't say that either. Truth is, giving to the Lord is neither a path to riches nor poverty, nor is it a guarantee of human happiness, nor sorrow. Here's what Scripture says, Matthew chapter 6. Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust do corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. Lay up for yourselves treasure in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, where thieves do not break in and steal, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. No promise of riches. And the suggestion is we ought to be looking at heavenly riches, not earthly. And as for happiness, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 18, this is what Peter says to the believers who are scattered. He says, servants, be submissive to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the harsh. For this is commendable. If because of conscience toward God, you endure grief, suffering wrongly. For what credit is it if you're beaten for your faults and you take it patiently? But when you do good and suffer, if you take it patiently, this is commendable before God. Now, does that sound like it's happy? Doesn't look that way to me. So the myth that giving to God will make me rich, we're going to bust that one too. Number two, I should give to God because God promises to reward giving with multiplied financial returns. Pastor Kevin once said in one of our elder meetings, he says, you want me to fill the auditorium? He says, I'll just change what I'm preaching. Meaning, I'll just change to stuff like this, and all of a sudden people will come. What does this mean? It means, well, you give God $1,000, you're going to get $10,000 in return, or you're going to get some multiple in return. Robert Tilton used to be a famous TV personality. I won't call him a preacher because his preaching was garbage. But he still has a website today, and here's what it says. Vowing always was and still is an expression of trust and dependence on the Lord. Provides a means for releasing our faith and focusing on God. Your tithe, 10% of your income, belongs to God. It's what you owe in thanksgiving for past blessings. That's not in the Scripture, by the way. A vow is something you promise God for future blessings. You can make a vow and you can expect a return. Sounds nice, doesn't it? Where does he get that from? Well, he takes it from Job chapter 22. Job chapter 22 is a guy named Eliphaz, one of three friends who come to visit Job, and they tell Job, Job, here's your problem. One says, Job, your problem is you're too much of a sinner. One says, Job, your problem is you're too self-righteous. And Eliphaz says, to get out of trouble, Job, here's what you got to do. You have to pray. You have to decide what you want. You have to pay a vow. And Tilton suggests a vow to pay is to send a check to him, by the way. Then to declare it to be done, and it will be yours. Magic formula to get out of all your troubles. Well, the problem is Eliphaz is preaching heresy. He's telling Job, Job, all your problems will be solved if this is what you do. The truth is Job has been selected or allowed by God for Satan to persecute him, not because he's evil, not because he's self-righteous, but because he is a true believer. So, not a good passage, Job 22, upon which to base your theology. So there's no place in Scripture where giving money to God is promised a financial return. If it were true, we're going to look at the widow who gave a few pennies a minute ago, in a few seconds. If it were true, I'd say she probably should have been granted amazing riches because she gave all that she had, but it's not what the Word of God teaches. So, myth number two, we've busted that one. So let's get to the point. What does the Bible really say? I mean, what does God really say about giving? I said this a moment ago, biblical giving is a reflection of my relationship to God, and here's what that looks like. Number one, biblical giving begins with God's perspective of money and stuff. You and I need to understand that what we have has absolutely nothing to do with you or me. Now, some of you are taken aback by that. You say, well, wait a second. After all I've done, well, let me give you an illustration. My brother's an education consultant in Austin, Texas, used to be head of a large private school. And I asked him one time, I said, where'd all the money in Austin, Texas come from? I mean, it just seems like a lot of rich people sending their kids to your school. Where'd they get all the money? And he said, well, a lot of it came from the dot-com bubble. And then he said this. He says, half of them think they were really smart, and the other half recognize they were really lucky. So back to you. Well, wait a minute. I worked hard. I went to school. I paid my dues. I sacrificed. I struggled. I put in the hours. I put in the time. Isn't this my reward? Well, here's the thing. How much of that had to do anything to do with you? How do you think you got here? Did you choose your nation of origin? Anybody pick that? Did you choose the family you were placed in? Anybody pick that? Did you choose what school was going to accept you? You may have chosen one to attend, but you didn't pick who let you in. Did you choose the job you had, or did somebody else pick you? Did you put yourself in the right position at the right time when the opportunity came? Did you do all of that? I would say no. I have a friend who runs an orphanage in Sierra Leone, West Africa. Most of the children in the orphanage are there because their parents have died of AIDS. And so I always use them as my litmus test for theology. If it's true for me, it's got to be true for that kid as well. And so I ask you, how many of you chose not to be an orphan in Sierra Leone? Because if you had been, maybe your life would look a lot different. I suggest it would. You get the point. Proverbs 16:9 says, a man's heart plans his way, but the Lord directs his steps. It wasn't your plan who got you where you are today. Matter of fact, most of us, when we get further downstream, we realize, wow, I am nowhere where I thought I'd be. This did not turn out according to plan. And usually that's a good thing. The Lord is making it happen. So whatever we have materially, whatever I have, it's all because of God. It has nothing to do with us. Second point on God's perspective. It can be gone in an instant. Now, I want you to raise your hand if you understand what I'm talking about. All right? It can be gone in an instant. Okay, very good. So let me explain. That'll take too long. If you don't know what that means, grab the hand of one of those people and ask them. All right? They'll explain it to you. Okay? But I think you know what I'm talking about. Second thing, biblical giving begins with a proper perspective of worship. Turn with me to Genesis chapter 4. We're going to get there in a moment. Genesis chapter 4, first book in the Bible. You know, in the Old Testament, there were two types of sacrifices that God initiated, generally speaking. The first was a sacrifice for sin. It was a blood offering, a covering of sin, a symbol of repentance, a symbol of mercy, of coming before God and confessing our wrongdoing. We no longer need this sacrifice. You no longer need to grab your animal, jump on a plane, and fly over to Israel any longer, because Jesus Christ is the one final sacrifice for sin. His blood was shed, covering the sins of the world. And so any of us who accept his free gift, our penalty has been paid. But the second type of sacrifice was a sacrifice of worship, or a sacrifice of gift offerings. I had a lunch appointment this week at Smoky Bones in Ellicott City, and I walked out of Smoky Bones, and woo, the aroma was amazing. I mean, it was spectacular. I'm not talking about a Gold's Gym next to Checkers kind of smell. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about barbecue just kind of oozing out there. It's interesting, in Leviticus, the first three chapters, God is going through all these different sacrifices, and these gift offerings are described to be a sweet aroma to the Lord. This is the picture of God being pleased with the sacrifice, God finding pleasure, enjoying, cherishing what his children are doing. So in Genesis chapter 4, we have the first sacrifice that we're aware of, gifts offered to the Lord. Cain and Abel, they're the brothers, sons of Adam and Eve. Verse 3 of Genesis 4, reading. And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought an offering of the fruit of the ground to the Lord. Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat. And the Lord respected Abel and his offering, but he did not respect Cain and his offering. And Cain was very angry, and his countenance fell. So the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why is your countenance fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin lies at the door, and its desire is for you. But you should rule over it." Now Cain talked with Abel his brother, and it came to pass when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel his brother and killed him. Now, what was wrong with Cain's sacrifice? It's suggested by some that they were told to bring animals and Cain brought produce. I'm not sure that that's true. That's not what the text necessarily says. What the text does say is that God did not respect or have regard for Cain the person, and his offering. And Cain's reaction to God's direction suggests that God wasn't looking at the gift as much as he was looking at the heart of the giver. Cain had a problem. And God warned him about his problem. And he became angry with God, which was a reflection of his problem. God said, "Sin is at the door of your heart. Beware, or it will rule over you." And Cain chose to allow it to rule over him, and he killed his brother. His heart was clouded with evil, was clouded with sin, and his selfishness, and he had an anger problem. So his sacrifice was not acceptable to God. God desires our worship. He desires a heart, though, that is walking in obedience to him. It's interesting, we can do the right thing, but do it with the wrong motives, and it's not pleasing to God. God is not interested in us pleasing him on our own terms. He is interested in our worship, our giving, out of a heart of humility, out of gratitude and obedience. So a proper perspective of money, a proper perspective of worship, and finally, biblical giving begins with a proper perspective, well, of giving. Turn with me to Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4, probably about 80% through your Bible, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. In Philippians chapter 4, we have the Apostle Paul speaking to a group of people in Philippi, whom he has visited and who have continued to share with him in support of his ministry. Philippians chapter 4, verse 14, Paul writes, "Nevertheless, you have done well that you shared in my distress. Now you Philippians know that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church shared with me concerning giving and receiving, but only you. For even in Thessalonica, you sent aid once and again for my necessities. Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that abounds to your account. Indeed, I have all and abound. I am full, having received from Epaphroditus the things you sent from you, a sweet-smelling aroma, there's those words again, an acceptable sacrifice, well-pleasing to God. Giving is pleasing to God. God desires that his children share in the work of the gospel and taking the truth of the word of God to the ends of the earth, to bring it to those who have never heard. We just approved our 2016 budget here at the church, and our missions budget for 2016 is $248,000. It's a 4% increase over last year, but in addition to last year's budget, you all gave an additional $40,000 for the work of the gospel, to see the word of God to go around the world. This is what Paul is applauding. This is what he's saying. He says, this is what you should be doing. You reached outside of yourselves, and you shared what you had to support those who God had called to go. So when you give, you are part of their work. That's what Paul was saying. You have shared with me, and as a result, when I go, I represent you. Giving is pleasing to God. The second thing about giving is that the dollar value or the percentage doesn't matter. It's not the point. Mark chapter 12, turn there briefly. Second Gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Mark chapter 12. It's very interesting in this passage. Jesus and his disciples, as was their custom at times, would go into the synagogue and really talk to anybody that wanted to talk to them. So in Mark chapter 12, we're getting toward the end of the day, verse 41. We read, now Jesus sat opposite the treasury and saw how the people put money into the treasury. Many who were rich put in much. Then one poor widow came and threw in two mites, which makes a quadrant. How much is that? It's less than a penny. Okay, so you get a perspective. It's less than a penny. Verse 43. So he called his disciples to himself, Jesus did, and he said to them, assuredly, I say to you that this poor widow has put in more than all those who have given to the treasury. For they all put in out of their abundance or wealth, but she out of her poverty put in all that she had, her whole livelihood. Now, if you get a chance to go back and look at this passage today or later this week, you'll note that Jesus, while he had sat there in the synagogue, had various encounters. Along came the Pharisees and the Herodians, and it was their custom to try to trick Jesus. They would ask him questions that they didn't really care to hear the answers to, and he would often stun them. And then he was approached by some Sadducees, more religious people, and then one of the scribes came. And then at the end of the day, possibly the most insignificant event that happened in the synagogue that day was a widow who came along and put pennies in the offering. And Jesus calls the disciples together. He says, come here, fellas, I want to show you something. Did you see that? And of course, probably they didn't see it. He said, did you see what just happened? This widow just put a penny in the offering. And they're thinking, yeah, well, big whoop. He says, that's the most important lesson you can learn today. Do what she did. All this conversation about theology and blah, blah, blah of all the religious people, you're not going to learn a lot from that, but you'll learn a lot by watching a poor widow give a penny. That's the model to follow. See, the dollar amount doesn't matter. For some, a tithe or 10% or however you want to portray it is an extreme hardship. If you're just barely surviving, that would be difficult. But for others, 10 or 20 or 30% or 50%, it's just a drop in the bucket. God's call to each is to give according to what's been given to them. If God has entrusted you with much, then he expects you to use it for his glory. If God has entrusted you with very little, then he expects you to use it for his glory. Same principle. The applications between you and the Lord. So giving is pleasing to God. God's not impressed with the dollar value. And finally, giving should be first. See the widow. It says she gave all without regard for her livelihood. God expects me and you to give up what is temporal for what is eternal. What does that mean? Biblical giving requires that I set aside some things that I might want, or even some things that I think I need, so that someone else's life is touched for eternity. Have you ever sat down and examined what you maybe have given up or sacrificed in order that you could give? For some, maybe it's a lot. For some, maybe it's very little. Maybe that's an exercise that you need to do. I'd encourage you to think about that. Let me read from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, the Apostle Paul writing, "So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you, always having all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for every good work." In this passage, what Paul says, he says, give intentionally, not out of whatever is left over. That's what it means to give as you purpose in your heart. In a consistent manner, intentionally thinking about it. Not begrudgingly or out of compulsion, but voluntarily and freely. Not because you feel obligated. Because God loves a cheerful giver. And to you, the cheerful giver, God is able to make all grace abound. That's the return on your investment. You'll have sufficiency in all things, abundant supply for the good work that God's called you to do. God will supply your needs. He doesn't promise you riches and wealth. You know why? Because that's not what we need. We need God's grace. We need his provision in our lives. We need to find our supply in him. I have the honor and privilege to speak in various places around the country to groups of people at special events who support the chaplains who serve with our organization. And at most of these events, we tell the stories and have former inmates share their testimonies about what God has done in their lives and what God is doing in jails and prisons around the world. And we get to the end of a calendar year, the end of 2015, I get to this year tell people that last year we saw over 50,000 inmates in over 400 facilities around the world make decisions to follow Jesus Christ. Amen. We do that, amen, yeah. And among these 50,000, all of them had a one-on-one conversation with a chaplain or a volunteer. So we're not just talking about counting hands of that seem to have gone up somewhere. And I get to tell that story and I get to encourage people about being part of our ministry. But I often close with this question and these thoughts, and this is how we're going to close this morning. Here's a real question, I think. What would you like God to do with what you have? What would you like God to do with what you have? You know, many of us claim that we recognize that all we have is God's. And yet when it comes down to it, we hang on to it as if our lives depend on it. So let me challenge you with this. Lives do depend on it. Eternal lives are at stake. And I guarantee you that an investment in the work of the gospel, a gift that supports the work of taking Jesus Christ to men, women, and children in our neighborhood and around the world who are in desperate need of a Savior, that gift will yield dividends that you cannot measure. Because when we give, we're making a difference in the lives of many, many people, most of whom you will never meet. But I have a feeling that one day in heaven, as we're gathered around the throne, we're praising the Lord, someone can walk up to you and shake your hand and say to you, "Thank you so much. I'm here because you gave." Let's pray. Father, we have far more than we need. And yet often we find ourselves looking at somebody else and wishing we had what they had. And yet, Lord, your challenge to us is, "My God shall supply all my needs according to his riches." Our challenge this morning, Lord, is that you would encourage us to use all that you've given to us, our time, our talent, and our treasure, to reach outside of ourselves and to make an impact in our world in a powerful and a meaningful way. We trust that you'll multiply our efforts, that you'll challenge our hearts, and use us for your honor and glory. For it's in your name we pray. Amen.